Hi, welcome to My Nation's big interview show, Face the Nation. I am Abhijit Majumdar, and with me, I have our defense correspondent Ajit Dubey. We are here to interview the man who heads 1.3 million of the world's most well-trained, disciplined, and when it comes to action, the most lethal men and women. He heads the world's second biggest army. Welcome to the show, General Bipin Rawat. Thanks for giving us time, sir. You and your forces are the reason why a billion Indians sleep well at night, enjoy the freedom that our forefathers have given. Although some of us use that freedom to take pot shots at the same forces and sometimes even go on to insult them. But that is another matter, sir. We are about 4 days away from the 10th year of 2611, the terrible tragedy that struck the nation in Mumbai, where so many people were killed, slaughtered. America responded to 9/11 with tremendous military might. Now, their geopolitical reality is different. But does India have the military wherewithal to respond to a 2611 kind of attack today?
At the outset, let me thank you for recognizing the efforts of the Indian Army, the other defense forces, and let me not forget the Central Armed Police Forces and the State Police for confirming that if the nation sleeps well, it is because the Indian Defense Forces and the other security forces and intelligence agencies are doing their job. Thank you for that. Specifically with respect to 2611, it was an act of terrorism which was perpetrated from across the borders. I mean, we have confirmed input to say that a thing of this kind had been initiated by Pakistan, conducted by people who had been trained there. And you know that we were able to even apprehend one of those terrorists. And so there was sufficient evidence. Now, with respect to your question on what we can do, you are aware that many years later after that, Uri happened. And we have displayed our will to carry out any action against our adversary, should such an action be repeated again. So in case any such incident happens again, the Indian Army, along with the other defense forces, is fully geared and prepared to undertake any mission that the government may assign to us.
Sir, just wanted to ask you, related to 2611, like recently the American President Donald Trump, he lambasted Pakistan for hiding Osama bin Laden for so many years. And then he also went on to say that how the American special forces had to get inside Pakistan to eliminate the main the perpetrator of their 9/11, Osama bin Laden. Now, with respect to 2611, we still see that Pakistan is still in a denial mode. No action has been taken against the perpetrators of 2611, Hafiz Saeed, Zakir Rahman Lakhvi, or for that matter, Uri mastermind, Jaish-e-Mohammed chief, Masood Azhar. Can the Indian forces also take out a similar, carry out a similar action to take out, say, Hafiz Saeed or a Lakhvi or a Masood Azhar the way the Americans did? Do we have the capability?
Well, let me tell you, we have the capability, but there are other ways of doing a similar action and bringing the perpetrators to book. If you look at the way the international diplomacy is today playing, if Pakistan is now facing the heat from not just the United States, but from many other nations around the world, it is because we have been able to achieve what we wish to achieve in a different manner. So I think the political hierarchy, along with the diplomacy that has played their part in the right direction, we have been able to achieve just the same purpose. Today, Pakistan stands isolated. Yes, we have not been able to bring the perpetrators to book as of now, but effort is on to reach out to them. and reach out to the international community to see that these people finally are booked either within their country or are handed over to us for further action to be taken.
Sir, is the restructure, I mean, Army has embarked on a restructuring mission. You are making it leaner and more effective. Would you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, I would say that restructuring, reorganization of the Army is an ongoing process. It is not something which is being undertaken for the first time. You know, you would realize that we had organizations, then we recreated divisions called Rapids. These were created for a different purpose. So reorganization, restructuring has always been on the agenda of the Army. Now we find that over the years, some of our structures have become obsolescent. Like equipment becomes obsolescent, so do structures become obsolescent. So there is a need to reorganize and restructure the Army. You know, we have to look at the changing nature of warfare. We do understand that non-contact warfare is gaining ground. Proxy war is something that we have been facing for very many years. And yet the threat of conventional warfare looms large on our borders. Therefore, we have to carry out restructuring to ensure that the force gets better strength to deal with the kind of warfare that we will be faced with in the future. That is non-contact warfare coupled with proxy war and then conventional war. So if you have to be prepared for that, then you have to recreate structures and reorganize yourself to make the Army stronger and capable for future.
Sir, non-contact war would mean what kind of engagement?
See, non-contact warfare would involve cyber warfare, legal warfare, information warfare, psychological warfare. All this is engulfed in non-contact warfare, where you do not come in direct contact with the frontline troops. You take on the other areas first. You weaken the adversary. Try and attempt to demoralize the adversary, the frontline troops, and then resort to attrition warfare. So I think we also have to be prepared for this and have to reorganize, restructure our forces so that we are better prepared for this kind of warfare in the future.
Sir, right now, are we prepared for war at short notice if, God forbid, we are pushed to it?
Well, this is a task which is given to us based on the Raksha Mantri's directive. We have to be prepared for any kind of action that the government gives to us. And there, it is a continuous process, so we continually train and prepare for any task that is assigned to the Indian Army and the Indian Armed Forces.
Sir, coming back to Pakistan, you said that Pakistan stands isolated and they have been cornered by the international community. Now the Prime Minister, now the Pakistani Prime Minister Imran Khan, it's been close to 100 days since he took over. And when he took over, you had said that we'll have to wait and watch to see whether things improve or deteriorate. So what is your assessment? Has the support for terrorist activities gone down, or since we are seeing in last few days there have been shelling or ceasefire violations, or has it gone up in recent times? Is there any reduction or increase in support to terror activities?
Well, I would say there has not been much of a change. Infiltration along the line of control has been continuing. We've been having engagements on the line of control and we've been targeting the terrorists. You are aware of the manner in which operations have been undertaken in this year itself after the elections in Pakistan. In the hinterland, you can see the situation remains the same. With while we have been eliminating a large number of terrorists, but people, particularly the locals, continue to join terrorist ranks because of the terrorist Tanzeems who get support from outside, continue to ensure that Indian armed forces remain embroiled in this kind of violent activities. And it is actually affecting only the people of Jammu and Kashmir. You know, it is for them to understand what is the best for them. And this situation can continue unless the people themselves begin to understand that they are merely becoming pawns in the hands of the Tanzeems who get support from Pakistan.
Sir, is our muscular policy in Kashmir not met expectations? Because while we have seen that every year more than 200 terrorists have been eliminated just in Kashmir each year, but the indoctrination and the new recruitment seem to be rising as well. So do you think, it's a policy we should review or go back to?
Well, I would disagree with you by saying that our policy is muscular. You know, our troops are operating under stringent rules of engagement. You can see the manner in which they fight. We are using arms which are small arms. Very rarely are we using, rocket launchers. It is finally when we find that the adversary is using similar weapon systems. Otherwise, we are actually carrying out terrorism activities just with small arms. So I don't think the policy is muscular. You are possibly referring to the policy being muscular in the sense that we have started getting after the terrorists to ensure that their numbers are kept within manageable limits. It is also to send a message to the terrorists and to the youth of Kashmir that if you join terrorism and the manner in which you are being pushed into joining terrorism, your survival will not be there for long. And therefore, elimination of terrorists who have taken up weapons, who are creating violence and disrupting peace in the valley, where the people actually want peace. I think the only way forward is to ensure that either the terrorists come overground, surrender, or they face the kind of action that we are doing.
But sir, why is there an increase in recruitment, jihadi recruitment?
Has it got anything to do with radicalization by organizations like Jamaat-e-Islami or the radicalization calls from the local mosques?
Yes, there is no doubt that radicalization is happening because of, I would say, disinformation campaign that is being spread in the valley. And that is why I think the youth are joining militancy. The other issue also is that whenever a terrorist dies, the kind of gatherings that happen during the janazas and the ceremonies that follow when the terrorist is being cremated, I think that is also one of the reasons which is possibly motivating youth to join terrorism.
So why don't you stop that?
Well, action is at hand, and I think gradually we are succeeding. Gradually you will see that the number of people joining these so-called martyrdom ceremonies are coming down.
So you will giving back the body to the family, or have a controlled burial somewhere?
See, on the one hand, you said, are we following a muscular policy?
No.
This is all adds to that. We are not following a muscular policy. And why I say this is because even when we kill a terrorist who's taken up arms against us, imagine we give the body back to the people, we take the body back home, and we allow his own near and dear ones to cremate them. So when we go to such limits, how do we call it a muscular policy? I think what we are doing is trying to tell the people that the Indian Army is not against you. Indian Army is here for you. We are here for bringing peace, for ensuring that there is no violence, and that we are here to support the people of Jammu and Kashmir.
Sir, I will again go back to the whole policy of handing over the bodies, because this is a concern that there are huge mobs which gather at those funerals. So what is the Indian state thinking, and the army? Can we somehow handle this?
Because they are acting as recruitment grounds for these tanzeems.
See, as I said, this is one of the reasons which is motivating you to join recruitment. So while we do not want to deny this aspect, that we do not hand over the bodies to the near and dear ones, but yes, controlling the number of people who come for these janazas and the number of times prayer is read for every terrorist who dies, I mean, that is what is being controlled, and I think we are succeeding in that to a large extent.
Sir, we wanted to talk about this. Recently there is a trend that they are kidnapping policemen or so-called informers. There have been ISIS-style beheadings, shooting people on gunpoint, taking videos, releasing them to the public, spreading them on social media. So is there an attempt by Pakistan to turn Kashmir into an ISIS-like territory, or the terrorism is going to become, the face of terrorism is going to become more dangerous there? What's this attempt? How do you see this?
See, I see this quite differently from what you think. I think this is mere frustration among the terrorist tanzeems when they resort to this kind of a thing. You see, initially they started with burning the panchayat ghars. While we were looking at taking the, you know, democracy down to the grassroots level through panchayat elections, so the moment the government announced the panchayat election, they started burning panchayat ghars. Then I think wisdom dawned on them and they said, no, this is possibly a good way. This is the way the development will take place, and possibly some kind of sense dawned on the people to say this is not the way forward. Then they started targeting the policemen. Well, the people in the Kashmir Valley have often been saying that they do not have job opportunities. At the same time, you are telling the police to give up their jobs and come home. I think that also didn't find favor. So now they have changed trend. They said, okay, now let's target the unemployed youth because they have nothing to lose. But when you start targeting unemployed youth, these are the same people who are joining your tanzeems, who are being motivated. So I think this is frustration. And when you carry out acts like this, the people themselves will rise against the terrorists and the tanzeems. And I think this is a grave mistake that is being carried out by the terrorist tanzeems. This possibly could lead to ultimate peace in the valley, because the people themselves will shun terrorism and will shun the terrorists, and may actually discourage youth from joining terrorist ranks, because this is barbarism which the Kashmiris have never believed in.
We wanted to quickly touch the Gogoi thing, where he had done something on the front lines, and you had encouraged him, and you had he had been rewarded. Then he made a grave mistake, and he's facing action for that. Do you think that the army has been a little harsh on him? Maybe would it affect the morale of the forces on the long run? Or
see, army is a very disciplined organization. We reward good work and we do not overlook acts of indiscipline. And that's all I would like to say. But when you said he's committed a grave mistake, you know, the inquiry has been completed. It's almost through. But the mistake was not as grave as has been made out to be by the media.
Sir, is India ready for another surge?
You had hinted recently that the way situation is developing on the LC.
Well, you see, I would say that let's not start talking of surgical strikes. As I've always said, there are options available, other options available, and yes, we are ready.
Okay. What are you doing to get more women in the army, and also the existing lot? How can they see a better future for them?
Well, we have decided to grant permanent commission to women in the army in selected fields, because we do understand that in some of the tasks that the our officers are required to perform, we need permanency. And wherever we need permanency, I think giving permanent commission to the women officers would be a good option. So we are quite confident that with this we will get good quality women in our army. We will also be able to ensure continuity in some of the tasks that are required to be performed by us.
Sir, very quickly, two last things. After Doklam, are things fine with China, back to normal? Because there have been some reports that there has been another build-up in Doklam some months ago, and etc., etc. I mean, not been proved, of course.
I think the mechanisms that we have adopted with the Chinese, right from the top level of the premier, prime minister with the premier of China, and right down to the level of the soldiers at the formation level, I think the mechanisms are working very well. We are now in the process of establishing hotlines between the two armies, and I think the mechanism for peace and tranquility that has been set rolling is working well, and we are seeing peace on the borders with China.
So one last question. Some people, and some of them are prominent public figures, loosely insult the army or say things about you that you have, General Rawat sometimes speaks like a bully, and he's very aggressive when he speaks, he should be more restrained, etc., etc. Indian army doesn't show restraint, etc. Even politicians have tried to undermine our surgical strikes, prominent politicians. How do you respond to it? I feel you all are the man at the front line, it must hurt you or...
No, I feel all military commanders at the higher level should be seen as being strong. So long as the leadership is strong and the rank and file perceive that their leadership is strong, I think we will have a good army, and that is what we want.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your precious time and your extremely candid answers. With this, we come to the end of this episode of Face the Nation. In the future, on My Nation, you'll have many more big interviews. Once again, I thank General Bipin Rawat for his time with us. Thank you.
Thank you indeed. And thank you for being here.